It's you've got decisions to make. You've got to be able to do what God wants you to do at that point in time. Right now, you've got a liberal professor who's trying to tell you that really there is no decision. Or you've got someone in your class that has confronted you with something that you're not quite sure you know the answers to when it comes to your beliefs in the Word of God. But you know what, folks? That's not just our kids that are graduating from high school. That's each one of us, amen? That's each one of us, day by day, as we try to just make it something to have across their lives. And you, the jobs I know that you have, and the families you have, and I realize that you have the storms of life that come peering in on you as well. Someone asked me this morning, they said, Pastor, how do you enjoy retirement? And I said to them, you know something, I finally realized something. Used to, when I asked a retired person, they do something, they said, I don't have time. I said, you're retired. I said, look, I'm easier now than I am off from work. In fact, I don't know how I have time to work. I'm so busy in retirement. Now, you know, that's really saying that you're busy. Really says, would you? I said, I'm too busy. She says, no, you're not that busy. Trust me. But if you find yourself with all kinds of things going on around you, well, let me tell you something, folks. Graduates, there's one we can turn to for the storms of life. Do I get an amen there? That one is Christ, the Lord himself. So in John chapter 6, verse 16, Father, we're going to see this morning that Christ truly is our help in life's storms. There's an old proverb that says, and listen to me, an old proverb that says, man's extremity is God's opportunity. Folks, that statement has its merits. However, there's another truth that I want to give you as well. And that truth says, man's extremity is also man's opportunity to discover an extreme God. That will help you in those dark hours of life's storm. In other words, trials in life can lead you to see and to know, my friends, the Lord of life. Yes, in the midst of extremities, there is a God who is extraordinary. In the trials and tribulations that come your way, you will learn there is a God who is extraordinary. The truth that we see in that is found in context of our scripture this morning. Let's read together, beginning in John chapter 6, verse 16 and following. Now, when evening came, his disciples went down to the sea. They got into the boat and went over the sea towards Capernaum. And it was already dark, and Jesus had not come to them. Then the sea arose because of a great wind that was blowing. So when they had rowed about 3 or 4 miles, they saw Jesus walking on the sea and going to the boat, and they were afraid. But he said to them, he says, I do not be afraid. Then that woman they received him into the boat, and immediately the boat was at the land where they were going. Pray with me, Father, thank you for your word. And I'm watching your words today. Hide me behind the cross for the Lord of the messy moment. Remember Jesus, and Jesus alone will be seen and heard. For it's in his name. Now, I want you to think about where the disciples found themselves right now. The disciples are in an extreme situation. They're out in the middle of the Sea of Galilee. And the storms that also have a tendency to do all that make the sea come up. And they're violent storms when they come up. They're in the middle of an extreme situation. But they discover something that you and I need to discover this morning. They discover that there is no extremity too extreme for God to show up. They discover on this night that there is no pain that is too painful for Jesus to meet. They discover I would not know what faith in God could do. You see, folks, storms or seasons and situations that we go through in this journey called life, we are just bigger and expanding into this journey we call life. And what you need to understand, graduates, is that storms are nothing more than seasons and situations that we go through from time to time. And as believers, we are challenged. We are challenged to use these storms for moments of gratefulness, for moments of discipleship. What's that mean? That means learning from God. When we are called and challenged to use it, because it will help us to be a more disciplined Christian in the faith of the Lord Jesus Christ. Let me tell you, no person, no believer goes through life without being caught up in a storm. Right? You've not been to where you are right now. You've not gotten to where you are right now without having gone through a storm. And listen to me on this thing called storms. There are all kinds of storms, folks, that we go through. There are all sorts of storms that will find the place where we're living. Let me say it again. There's all kinds of storms that will find the place where you're living. Others where you are at this very moment, storms are going to come, and they're going to find you. Satan's going to make sure of that. There are storms of illness that affects our bodies, and they leave us weakened by the real presence. There are storms of failures that capture our minds and hearts. There are storms of criticism that we find ourselves in because of not living like other people that we should. There are storms of relationships that make us ask ourselves more than we want to admit. What's wrong with me? Am I coming from a sin yet? There are storms of loss. There are storms of grief. And then the greatness that could crush our souls. But sometimes those storms just will not leave us quick enough. But they just will fall. Now, in my context, with what we read a few moments ago, and the scripture we just read, in context, we see the miracle of the multitude defeating us. Of the 5,000 right before the storm came up, before the disciples were going out across the Sea of Galilee. The feeding of the 5,000, of course, by all the four gospel writers. But I want you to know something about this storm that John gives to us right here in the beginning of his book. John places this story in the middle of this effort on the people's part to make Jesus king. The other account of Peter getting out of the boat and walking on the water almost drowning. Neither does John's account include him are doing, you need to understand. Do it all if you're trying to be obedient. Do it all if you're trying to be faithful. Do it all if you're trying to go find out. And the headwind comes. Please understand. Jesus is the Lord. A headwind is a wind that blows against you as you try to progress to the place of God and belief and having a life that is filled with walking with Christ. The text says that while they were trying to get where Jesus told them to go, the wind blew against them and the sea apparently became turbulent. Sometimes in my life, and I know in yours as well, sometimes I can get a sense of operating in faith. I get a sense of operating in doing what God wants me to do in faith and doing God's will. I know that's what I'm supposed to be doing because the winds are blowing against me. The winds of resistance are blowing against me. You sometimes feel in a sense of your spiritual direction. Such as when you're trying to be righteous. Resistance comes against you. Sometimes when you're trying to be beautiful and do what you know God wants you to do, and God shows up in the form of a wind against you. When you are trying to be purposeful, honestly, and serving God, and problems present themselves. Strong in the Lord. And the throne reaches up and grabs your strength. When you're trying to rise above the fray of foolishness, and every time you try to rise above the fray of foolishness, fragmented thoughts just kind of get in your way. And the wind blows against you. Paul would say it this way. When you would do good, evil is always present. You know what you need to do when that happens? Number one, when it happens, you have to press your way. What the disciples do, they have to wait for the break. Scripture says they kept rowing, pressing against the storm. They kept trying to get where they needed to be. You know what we need to say? We need to simply say, "This devil, if you're going to get me, you're going to have to get me going the wrong way, even if the wind's blowing right now. Even if the wind's blowing against me, if you're going to get me, you're going to have to get me going the wrong way." Don't forget that, young people. When you go into the world, don't ever forget that Satan's going to get you. He's going to have to get you doing the right thing. But then you know what? When this happens and the wind can come against you, you need to learn to pray your way around. You've been taught to pray. I know you've been taught to pray. And the only thing that can help the headwinds that Satan throws against us is a life filled with prayer. A life reaching out to the Lord. But that's if you haven't figured that out by now, you need to do that. I don't think there's one of us that doesn't have a headwind in our life somewhere. And we're willing to get to be where Jesus wants us to be. Lastly, why does Christ come to help us? Christ comes to help us to show us He will come to you in spite of what you're going through. To show us that He will get to you in spite of what you're going through. Look at verse 20. They said to him, "It is I, do not be afraid." Then they willingly received him into the boat, and immediately the boat was at the land where they were going. Now get this today. If you don't get anything else that we said today, you get this. The text says that he showed up on the water in the middle of the storm. He did not wait until the storm subsided. He did not wait until the got the all clear and the sirens quit blowing. He came while they were in the middle of the storm. much Jesus has done, has shown him, and be right here with him. That's what I love the name of the story. This is that reminder, folks. The reminder of God is here with me. The storms tend to cause us to lose sight of the right eye of God himself. Tends to lose sight, it says, and strength is sometimes. Scriptures where there was no word for faith in their understanding. And one day as they returned from a hunt, they killed several large deer, and they brought them back to camp for the village people. They suspended the huge animals on poles with their legs tied to the poles, and they carried them on their shoulders from pole to pole. When they arrived, they were all very tired. They were weary. They were weighted down from the journey. And one of the natives reached the porch, dropped his load, said in his mind, maybe it's